Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome once again. Now, the word legend is greatly overused, but tonight we really do have a legend in the world of English cathedral music. So it gives me the greatest of pleasure to introduce Dr. Barry Rose for what I know is going to be a fascinating evening. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, the statutory microphone test, those of you who are on the loop, can you make sure you can hear what I'm saying and just tune in? Are we all tuned in? Yes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, I can't go beyond that.
Yes.
Good, excellent. May I just start with three thank yous before I get on to the meat of my talk. Thanks to Colin for asking me. Thanks to my assistant there, Mark, who hopefully is going to play all the illustrations at the right moment. And thanks to you for coming. If you were here last night, you would have heard a wonderful talk by Roy Massey, who spent the first hour talking about two of his predecessors at Hereford. What you have to realise is that Guildford Cathedral had no predecessors, the new Guildford Cathedral. So I can't spend the first hour doing that. You'll be thrilled to know. So I'm going to go right back to the beginning. All my life, I've been fascinated by the art of singing and the art of organ playing, but also by the art of recording and also broadcasting. And I count myself so fortunate to be involved in every one of those things. For me, it's been a real journey of faith. That's faith with a small F and faith with a capital F. And I'm going to take you back nearly 80 years, to the 1940s. What do you want to be when you grow up? How many times were you asked that question by your parents or some well-meaning aunt or uncle? I lost count of the number of times I was asked, but one particular occasion sticks in my mind. It was an afternoon in July 1950, that's just over 68 years ago. I was 16, and it was my very last day at school in Walthamstow, East London. I wasn't academically good enough to stay on for the sixth form. So I had to leave and go out to work. We were going through the usual end-of-term ritual of our reports being handed out by our form master. In those days, you took them home with you. He got to mine, and having seen all the disparaging remarks on it, he gave a great sigh, looked directly at me over the top of his glasses, and said, "Rose, what do you want to be if you ever grow up?" I reckon either I laughed or had a heart attack if I then stood up in front of the whole class and said, "Well, sir, I think I'd like to run 3 cathedral choirs, work for the BBC as only one of 3 religious music advisors in the whole of their history, make gramophone records that sell in their hundreds of thousands, and also not just be a record producer, but also found and run my own record company." Pie in the sky, as they say. And with a list like that, one thing is absolutely certain. You're much more likely to become a musical jack of all trades than to be a master of any of them. And I leave you and other people to be the judge of that. Now, I'm sure every one of you here this evening can recall some seminal moment in your life when you can say, "That's really when it all began for me." Mine were in the East London suburb of Chingford. 2 very distinct early influences that were to set me on the musical path that I've followed for the past 70 years or more. The first was an HMV record that I found in my grandmother's sideboard drawer. This is it. There. Long playing records had yet to be invented, so you either played it on a wind-up gramophone or one of those snazzy new Marconi or HMV radiograms. I was a 12-year-old boy, and I had never heard anything like this in my life before. What is it? You'll recognise it straight away. Made in the late 1920s, that was the first church music record to qualify for the award of a platinum disc, over a million copies. I've got one as well, but that's no matter. It was so popular that Ernest Lough, the treble soloist, had to record it a second time. At least, that's what Google would have you believe. Actually, that's not quite correct. How do I know that? I was lucky enough to ask his choir master, George Talbot Ball, face to face, what really happened. Listen.
It was re-recorded three times. Somebody said, oh, it couldn't be done again, but it was done and then recorded again in 6 months, after 6 months, and then again after another 6 months. And it's very difficult to tell which record, which is which. Except the last one is rather slower than the first one.
I see.
And it's not quite the same age, quite the same brilliance in the voice. It's a slightly fuller tone. Otherwise, I still think the original record is the best.
And Ernest Lough was how old when he sang this?
15.
15. In these days, of course, boys' voices...
That's the real trouble with boys' voices breaking, as we find them breaking at 12 and... 13, but we very rarely get a 15, 16, and that sort of thing. At one time, one of the tenors in the choir, and he was saying the other day, when he was in the choir, the head boy was 18, the head boy of cantoris was 17. He said, we had 3 16s and 5 15s. They all knew their job jolly well.
He was free out of work as well.
Look, their voices were free. They didn't sound old, you know. That was a natural... You see, Lough recorded the last recording, he was 16.
Yes.
15, 15 and a half, and 16.
What was the last recording he made?
Hear my prayer again.
Yes.
It was re-recorded a year after the first recording.
The second really formative influence in my young life was this 12-inch record I'm holding up here. Issued in 1950, and I played it, and I played it, and I played it until the surface had been virtually worn out. You'll recognise the piece straight away, though you may not realise that the choir is Francis Jackson's choir at York Minster, accompanied by his then very young assistant, Alan Wicks, the late great Alan Wicks. This is such a good setting for the Magnificat, and I always hope that one day I might have a choir that could sing it as well as this. And I hope I did. So with the help of modern technology, I give you 1950 in York Minster, which moves over seamlessly to the choir of St Paul's Cathedral 30 years later in April 1980.
My soul hath made me my own.
If you've been around 17 years ago and wanted to be a church musician, all you had as models were a few gramophone records, the weekly broadcast of choral evensong, and the annual 9 lessons and carols from King's College Chapel, Cambridge. There was no YouTube, there was no Facebook, and certainly no archive of recorded church music in those days. So where was young Rose in all this? My father and my mother scraped enough money together for me to have some piano lessons, and they'd also sent my sister and myself to the local Sunday school. A couple of years later, I'd started playing the hymns on the piano at Sunday school. And it was then that the young curate heard about me and asked my parents if they'd let me play in his corrugated iron mission church, playing the piano. No, actually, it was a harmonium there, but it didn't work very well. Now, I ought to explain that several years of doing that meant that we made one recording while I was there. And a few weeks ago, with Colin's help, we managed to resurrect the very first recording I ever made around 1949 in that corrugated iron mission church, playing the piano at their Christmas carol service. I ought to explain that in those days, any recordings like this were cut directly on what they call a shellac disc. I could drop that disc on the floor and it wouldn't break like these records here would break if I dropped them on the floor. And every time it was played, you wore a bit more of the surface away, so it was a very limited number of times you could play it. You can just about hear my piano playing and the singing of our tiny church choir over the hiss and the scratch. And like the Stanford Magnificat, I never dreamed that some years later I'd be directing that very same carol with my own choir, but in the great spaces of St. Albans Abbey. And again, through the magic of modern technology, both performances have been cut together on this very short excerpt, 1949 and 1989, side by side. BBC iPlayer in the early 50s. The only way to hear those broadcasts was to record them. But how? Domestic tape recorders had only recently come onto the market, and through a legacy from my late grandfather, I bought one of the very first portable ones, a Grundig TK5 model. Now, I connected it up to the output sockets on the back of our home radio, and all it needed was my mother to push the record button when the broadcast began, and I could listen to it when I got home late in the evening. Tape was expensive to buy, so the following week you'd record over the week you'd done before. If only I kept some of those. They could have been real treasures here in the
archive.
But, all is not completely lost, since here is a short excerpt from one that was kept. The very first broadcast of the Magnificat from the St. Paul's St. Paul's service from the chapel of King's College, Cambridge, with Boris Hall directing his choir and the late Hugh MacLean playing the organ. Just before it's played to you, two of the boy choristers at that time ended up singing tenor in my choir at Guildford Cathedral, and one of them told me that his mother happened to be in Cambridge on the day of that broadcast and was going to attend the service. As she reached the door of the chapel, she ran straight into Boris Orb, who greeted her with the words, "I wouldn't come in here if I were you. You won't like all this nasty modern music." It was around that time that I met Brian Head, whose name you won't know, but Brian was one of the tenor chorus scholars, and he happened to live quite close to me in Chingford, and we struck up a friendship. Brian also had an interest in sound recording, and he and some of the other chorus scholars at King's had also acquired a tape recorder. And they secreted it in the chapel, and without telling Boris Org, they used to record some of the services. The audio quality was never very good because it was hidden away under a seat somewhere. But sitting in the front room of Brian's home was the very first time I ever heard pieces on the scale of E.W. Naylor's Vox Decentis, for instance, the eight-part setting. And the one that stuck in my mind most was Samuel Wesley's monumental eight-part setting of In Exitu Israel, a huge piece. How many people know In Exitu Israel? Fantastic piece. And they'd sung that at Evensong on Easter Day 1955. Somehow, we rigged up our two tape recorders so I could have a copy of it. And I vowed that if ever I had a choir good enough, then we would sing it. Ha ha. Easier said than done, believe me. Well, here's the end of that King's College actual performance on Easter Day 1955. And would you believe it? Just 5 years later, in September 1960, my own church choir at St Andrew's Kingsbury, St Andrew's Kingsbury, you can read about it up there, was able to sing it in an evensong in St Paul's Cathedral. So, ladies and gentlemen, for the very first and probably the last time, I give you the choir of King's College, Cambridge, and the choir of St Andrew's Church, Kingsbury, side by side. I think you'll easily spot which is which. Or will you? The mid-1950s was the time when the King's College Choir made its very first long playing record. And of course it had to be the Festival of Nine Lessons and Carols. There's an apocryphal story that two King's undergraduates decided to form a record company and they called it ARGO, A-R-G-O, an acronym of their initials, Andrew Rayburn and Geoffrey Owen. I'm not sure if that's true, but the mind boggles as to what it might have been called if it had been founded by Christopher Robinson and Andrew Parrott. This is that very record. This is it, complete with black and white cover. And those of you who heard it will know it's somewhat unusual, since the carols themselves are recorded in the wonderful acoustics of the chapel, whilst the lessons seem to have been recorded in someone's front room. Maybe they couldn't afford to hire the chapel for those. But nothing, can take away from the superb and expressive singing of Boris Hall's choir. I just wonder why we all bother after this. In my view, in just one verse of one carol, you can hear that there's been very little, if anything, to match it since this 1954 performance.
Thank you.
believe there's a James Bond theme song that says nobody does it better. I think that's probably true. If you have a tape recorder, you obviously want to use it to record things. But where? Well, I had the new church in Chingford, but I was about to leave there and take the most influential step in my whole musical life, joining a choir and learning really how it's done from the inside. The finest church choir anywhere at that time was in Hampstead Parish Church in northwest London. Martindale Sidwell, the choir master, had been appointed in 1946, and by the early 1950s, his choir was well known for its many broadcasts and recordings, and they were really good. Listen.
Festival cantata, Rejoice in the Lamb, by Benjamin Britten, brings to an end this recital of choral music given by the Hampstead Parish Church Choir, conductor Martindale Sidwell, with Rafe Downs at the organ.
And that was in Maida Vale One studio, not even in their church. Having played the piano and the organ for so long, I hadn't had any experience as a singer. A friend gave me a bit of coaching, and after a rather nervous audition with Martindale Sidwell, he actually offered me a place in the choir. So early in 1956, I became Decanite Bass 2. And during the following 18 months, I learned most of what I know about choir training through singing in the back row and observing the way he worked with the trebles. It was a life-changing experience. My very first Sunday morning at Hampstead was a live BBC broadcast, and a few weeks later we assembled on successive Saturdays to sing for the soundtrack of a film, and the following week to make a 7-inch EP record of Christmas carols. Here's a bit of one of those carols we recorded that morning. July 1957. I'm one of the four basses. my first broadcast as a singer. Was a chorister at King's College, Cambridge. Like today's Eddington Festival, the festival choir was made up of trebles from cathedrals and collegiate chapels, with a back row of Cambridge choral scholars, and these few men from Hampstead Parish Church, who'd actually helped start it. "Why don't you come with us?" they said. So for the next week, I was part of the festival, which also included visits to St Albans and Cambridge. On one of these visits, Christopher Bishop, whose name you may know as a famous EMI producer, did a lot of the very famous records of EMI. Their conductor, he was at that time, suggested I might record them. So I got my little grunting tape recorder out and a tiny little microphone that I'd recently bought, and I made my very, very first recording of a choir. It's not been heard since that day. In 1957, perhaps that's just as well with my recording, but you're in for a world premiere here this evening. Ashwell Festival Choir, directed by Christopher Bishop, recorded by Barry Rose, singing Thomas Wilkes's Hosanna to the Son of David in no less a place than the Chapel of King's College, Cambridge.
Thank you.
coming here, I actually contacted Christopher Bishop, who's still alive. He said, don't forget to remind everybody that there were some choristers from Worcester Cathedral in that year at Asheville. I was still working in insurance, but I longed to have a choir of my own. I mentioned this to some of my back row colleagues in Hampstead, and they suggested that we set up a group to include them and some sopranos they knew. The best mixed choir at that time, the best known mixed choir, was Louis House's Elizabethan Singers. And after a bit of discussion, we decided to call ourselves the Jacobean Singers. Our first concerts were in December 1957, when we sang Heinrich Schütz's Christmas Story in two different London churches. And soon after, we started broadcasting, often on those 30-minute Music at Night programmes. You probably remember some of those. It was my first attempt at running a choir, and to be honest, I was learning as I went along, helped by some really talented singers. This is a small montage of some of the items in what I think is the only recording in existence of one of our Christmas broadcasts. You will hear excerpts from A Medieval Carol, Good Day, My Lords, I Christmas, Good Day, Jean Joubert's setting of There Is No Rose of Such Virtue. These are all snippets. Peter Warlock's Valu La Lo, Oh My Dear Heart, Oh Jesus Sweet. The ever popular Three Kings from Persian Lands Afar. And finally, a bit of Orlando Gibbons' verse anthem, See the Word is Incarnate. And can you, any of you, guess the identity of the soloist in Three Kings, making his first ever appearance as a solo, as a soloist on the radio?
Good day.
Oh, The anthem, See the Word is Incarnate, by Orlando Gibbons, ends this recorded performance of Music for Christmas. It came from the Church of St. George the Martyr, Queen Square, London, and it was given by the Jacobean Singers, conducted by Barry Rose, who also played the organ.
Soloist in Three Kings. Any volunteers?
Barry Rose.
No, Ian Partridge, CBE, his very first broadcast, Ian Partridge, the one and only Ian Partridge. 1957 was a bit of a turning point in my life, because Martin Dale Sibrel took me aside and told me in no uncertain terms that I should get on, get out and run my own cathedral or church choir. He said, you'll find just how hard a job it is, my boy, he said. He was right. I applied for the post of organist and choir master at St. Andrew's Church, Kingsbury, about which you can read here, of course, it was St. Andrew's Wells Street, and went there to find the boys' choir already up and running. I had no idea, really, how to take a choir practice, apart from what I'd seen Martin Dove Sibrel do in Hampstead. So it was a real baptism of fire. We started with two practices a week, and a couple of years later, every boy was attending up to four practices a week, and willingly, I might add. It was, always was just an ordinary parish church choir, but we were lucky that several of the altos, tenors and basses, whom you've heard from the Jacobean singers there, would come along and sing at evensong each Sunday night, and also at special events. This is the 1959 Christmas Carol service in Kingsbury. Sunday Times, and he came to a concert in which I was playing and was brutally frank afterwards. You need some proper organ lessons, he said, and the best person to teach you is C.H. Trevor at the Royal Academy of Music. Go there, he said. I was 24, I didn't even have grade 1 on the piano, and they wanted grade 8 to get in. But I did go and audition to Sir Thomas Armstrong, who was the principal of the Royal Academy of Music. Sir Thomas had been a cathedral organist himself, and I think he took pity on this young would-be church musician, and he let me in. For the next 2 years, I juggled my time between Kingsbury and the Academy, and it was while I was there that my flatmate bounced in one evening, threw down a copy of the Daily Telegraph, open at the Situations Vacant General column, and said, here, have you seen this? This was an advertisement which read as follows. Organist required for new Guildford Cathedral. Situations Vacant General, you The post may be combined with that of Director of Music at the Royal Grammar School. Applications to the Provost of Guildford, Castle Gate. I'd recently failed my ARCO exam, but undaunted, I sent off my application and was surprised to get a phone call from the provost saying, would I be free to come to the Royal College of Music for an audition and interview in 2 weeks' time? Now, his decision to make that phone call might have been influenced by the fact that at that very time, the boys of the Kingsbury Choir were doing a series of weekly broadcasts on the radio on a programme called Christian Outlook. rehearsing and singing upper voice anthems suitable for parish church choirs. The BBC had come to the church with a very basic handheld tape recorder and taken bits of choir practice. I went up to the BBC studio for the live broadcast to talk about what we were doing and why we were doing it. The boys, and at the end of the programme, the boys sang the whole anthem, accompanied by the organ. It was my very first broadcast as a speaker, and it sounds rather like it. I'm making really heavy weather of reading from a script like this, very stilted and somewhat painful to listen to. The boys also didn't sing that well, but since nothing had been done like it since Walford Davis back in the 1930s, the whole series was well received, and it just might have had some influence on me being offered the job at Guildford. No one here this evening will ever have heard this, not even Colin, nobody. A short excerpt from one of the later programmes. I think I'm going to hide under the chair while you listen.
And we listen to the boys of St Andrew's Parish Church, Kingsbury, practising an anthem for treble voices called "O Turn Away Mine Eyes, Lest They Behold Vanity." But there's one unusual feature this time. Barry Rose, who is St Andrew's choirmaster, and who will become organist at Guildford Cathedral in September, is in the studio with a chance to comment on the rehearsal as it proceeds. Barry Rose.
The restoration of the monarchy in England brought a great revival of our own English church music. Boyce and Purcell, in particular, set great passages of scripture to music, dividing them into movements for solo voices, duets, trios, choruses, and so on. Although some of these great anthems are too ambitious for the ordinary parish church choir, single movements from them often stand quite well on their own. Tonight's item, Boyce's setting of words from Psalm 119, "O turn away mine eyes, lest they behold vanity," is in fact an aria from such an anthem. The music is in the typical rhythmic style of the period, almost a minuet and very tuneful. In any boys' choir, there will be a good many boys who are not able to read music, so it's always a help to have an attractive, tuneful melody, so much easier to learn. We will assume that the choir has learnt the basic essentials of the anthem and can sing the notes correctly, but once again we'll listen to part of the final practice. Yes, now the point about that is that the words are "lest they behold." Now anybody listening at the moment would think it was "less they behold." It's "lest they behold." And you sing on a vowel sound the whole time in music up to the last second when you put your consonants in. And not only must the S be there, but the T must be there as well. We don't want that. How's it going to be prevented?
Say the sound over again.
Yes. That is, you repeat the vowel sound, "that I may fear ear thee." You sing it on a different ear sound. "That I may fear thee," it follows. Let's do that, please. "O establish thy word," it is, not ward. "O establish thy word in thy servant." Servant. Spelt servant. Pronounced servant, servant. Let's try, please, "establish." That point about servant may seem trivial, but I found it necessary to put it right every time we've sung this anthem. And now let's skip to the final rallentando, which brings up the whole problem of keeping choir and organ together.
Mm-hmm. start at the end?
Just at the end of fear. Then.
Yes. Here. It's slowing up all the time. Then go from the last bit, established, please. And it is established. Nothing else will do. Two beats, second line down. One, two. I don't see how you can expect to sing together when you don't look. It's impossible. Let's just do that last bit again, please, that I may fear thee. After 2.5 beats. All right. Two boys weren't looking. What should they have been looking at? Our organ and console at St. Andrew's are in the West Gallery, and the choir stalls in the chancel, with the whole church between us. So I always have the leaders on each side of the choir conducting. And I don't mean just wagging their fingers in time with the organ to keep the choir together. They actually set the time, and I follow them. Where you can get boys with enough musical sense to do this, it means that the choir as a whole ceases to be solely dependent on the organ. I think you'll agree that the leaders were handling that rallentando quite skillfully, though two boys let them down by not looking. Anyway, it's time we heard the performance.
A few months after we recorded that broadcast, or those broadcasts, I moved to Guildford and I started to found a new choir for the new cathedral. Now you're going to be surprised that I'm not going to talk about the music at Guildford this evening. Got my Guildford tie on, that's enough. There's a huge archive out there from my time on YouTube. At a flick of a button now, you can listen to hundreds, and I mean hundreds, of different items recorded at evensongs and concerts, as well as some of our broadcasts and early recordings. And all of this is thanks to the Archives of Sound channel. That's slightly different from this archive here. The Archives of Sound channel, whose founder is actually here this evening. So thanks to him. There are also, of course, several Guildford items in Collins' archive as well. I'd just like to say three very short things about Guildford. One, I only got the job through the faith shown in me by Walter Bolton, the provost of Guildford. He went against all the musical advice he received and appointed this unknown and unqualified parish church organist. Two, the new choir would never have made any real progress without the most talented and loyal group of men who sang in the back row, and a really musical and supportive presenter. And lastly, it was the right thing for both the choir and me to have a change after 14 years. Philip Moore, Andrew Millington, Stephen Farr, and now Catherine Beamish-Williams have all put their own stamp on the music of Guildford. My wife and I will be there this coming weekend to celebrate with former choristers from the past 58 years. God willing, we'll still be here for the Diamond Jubilee of the consecration in 3 years' time, a day in May 1961 I will never, ever forget.
This is Richard Dimbleby speaking from Guildford in the county of Surrey. Guildford, where at the foot of Stag Hill, we're looking at the new Cathedral Church of the Holy Spirit, to be consecrated in a few minutes' time this afternoon by the Bishop of Guildford in the presence of Her Majesty the Queen. This will be only the second cathedral in the southern province of England on a new site to be consecrated since the Middle Ages.
In the name of God, let us begin.
Write a book about that day. I've already talked about the BBC in the context of choral evensong, and like most cathedral organists, I'd taken part in the weekly broadcasts. But I never dreamt that one day I'd not only be responsible for choosing the venues for the whole series, but also being a regular producer for the programme. For many years, there'd been a music advisor to the head of religious broadcasting, and the first of these was Henry Walford Davies. Walford was a regular broadcaster in the 1930s, and he even had his own weekly series, one of which was called Talking About Music. Here he is on a very scratchy recording in one of those live broadcasts.
This talk is about the meanings of melody. Try always to give meanings to every melody you hear, even if you hear a mere fragment. Melody seems even simpler in its meanings than words. It seems really a mother tongue because languages like Latin, Greek, English, all local languages may die, but it is hard to see how melody can die. Its ways are natural, its words are such as last. The mere words, how are you, I hope you're very well, may mean 100 shades of meaning and be said 100 ways. But has it ever occurred to you that if we greeted each other with a precise scrap of melody and meant it, we should better know each other's state of mind? How are you? I hope you're very well. Compare that with another man who may say to you, how are you? I hope you're very well. Of course, if everybody went about singing, it might make the world rather too much like a comic opera. I wonder. Anyhow, let us remember that while words set in order can convey perhaps more definite meanings than music, yet tones set in order can also convey meaning.
That's a very rare recording of Walford Davies, and the only known recording of him actually singing. When Walford died, George Talbot Bolt, whose voice you've already heard, was appointed as the second music advisor to the head of religious broadcasting, and it was a post he held until he retired in 1969. Early in 1970, I was asked to play the organ in a live broadcast of the Duraflay Requiem from Guildford Cathedral, the broadcast to take place later in the year. The conductor that evening was John Poole, and in conversation afterwards, he mentioned the fact that the religious broadcasting department were looking for a new music advisor. Would I like him to mention my name? Of course, I said. 2 weeks later, after an informal lunch with the head of religious broadcasting, I became the third and the last music advisor. In true BBC fashion, the post was discontinued after I retired from it in 1991. So what did the music advisor do? The official duties were to direct the music in the daily service broadcast each day from All Souls Church in Langham Place. The choir was 8 members of the BBC singers, they took it in turns, and the form of service was taken from a book called New Every Morning, the music consisting of a short introit, 2 hymns and a psalm, often sung unaccompanied. Recordings of these services are almost impossible to find. But here's a bit of a psalm from a daily service on a Saturday morning, mind you, in 1974, broadcast live from the unhelpful and very dry acoustic of the concert hall in Broadcasting House. We couldn't use All Souls because there was a wedding going on that day. And for those interested in these things, the chant for the psalm is by Herbert Murrell, who is a former head of music at the BBC.
Now we turn to our psalm from the broadcast Psalter, the first 12 verses of Psalm 147, beginning, O praise the Lord, for it is a good thing to sing praises unto our God.
I was soon to find out that there was a lot more to that job than the daily services. You were expected to be not just a choir conductor and an organist, but also a pianist, a composer, an arranger, and even a book reviewer. Added to that, I was given my own television series on BBC Two, when I visited various cathedrals to talk about and hear them sing music associated with their buildings. One of these was at Worcester Cathedral, where I was allowed to interrupt Donald Hunt's morning practice in the chapter house. I put him right on the spot in this unrehearsed interview.
Donald Hunt, forgive me for interrupting choir practice, but we've all heard the sound of the Worcester Choir, now we're anxious to find out how it's done. So perhaps I can ask you, first of all, a few questions about the history of the choir.
Well, there's evidence of having been a boys' choir here since about the 13th century. But the actual foundation, as we know it today, was begun by Henry VIII, and the foundation consists of 12 choristers. We have more than that, you can see. Some of them are singing boys and others are probationers, and they're all educated at the King's School, which was founded by Henry VIII at that time.
So can you tell me the age range of the boys in this room?
Well, I like to get them to start at about 8, normally speaking, and they should leave the term in which they attain their 14th birthday.
So they come along here and they work as probationers?
Yes.
And then they come to be choristers?
Yes.
Now what happens when they come in the mornings? Do you sort of work on the sound that you want with them? And if so, how do you get it?
Well, I have to admit, I don't know how I get it, I think, probably, but I have to admit that when we come in the mornings, we've got to sort of get the sleep out of their eyes, first of all. And we usually do that by doing the music for the day immediately and seeing if there are any problems, and then I can build in any sort of choir training into that, really, as applies as necessary.
That's it. Both of my predecessors at the BBC have been actively involved in weekly choral evensong directing their own choirs, and I've also done the same. What I hadn't expected to do was to be handed the entire responsibility for what is the BBC's longest running outside broadcast, which first began 92 years ago in 1926. There was no real training in how to be a producer. I think that my superiors at the BBC thought that as a practicing cathedral organist, I would know how to handle my colleagues, some of whom could be quite difficult, but not quite as difficult as some of the clergy I had to handle. I've been reading this for years, my boy, you know, yeah, I can tell, yes. My primary job was to select the venues, which up to then had been scheduled on a regional basis, totally regarding whether the choir was any good or not. Some of the weekly broadcasts have been really pretty awful. Gradually, I won over the trust of my colleagues, so much so that when we got to the rehearsal and the balance test in the cathedral, they would whisper in my ear to have a go at that lay clerk over there or that one over there, who usually sang too loud or sang flat most of the time. They'll take it from you, they said, if you tell them. Oh good, I thought. No doubt they'll be waiting for me in some dark alley after Seduct Me Up. For those who don't know, the weekly live broadcast of Choral Evensong is preceded by about 2 hours by a rehearsal and balance test, ostensibly for the BBC engineers. It's here that the producer can make any practical and musical points, either privately to the choir master or over what we call the talkback speaker, so that the whole choir can hear. These rehearsals are never recorded. Well, they're not meant to be recorded. But tonight you can have the privilege of eavesdropping on a part of a 1980 rehearsal in the chapel of St John's College, Cambridge. Before I get this played, I'm going to cut it short because time is marching on and I've got one or two other examples. So I'm going to let you just get a flavour of this, and forgive me if I kill it slightly earlier than I have planned. Right, okay, George Guest is directing the choir, and I'm the disembodied voice that's talking out of the loudspeaker from the BBC van.
Set our levels with it. I think what I would like to hear is the speech that follows it, because I think the perspective between that and the intro is very important. So could you possibly sing the last two bars with once more and the speech just start?
Yes, right. One, just the bottom line will go for that today. That was too much. That's cool. 3, 4, 1, 2.
God is gone up with a merry noise, and the Lord with the sound of the trump. O sing praises unto our God. O sing praises unto our King.
Good, that's fine, thank you. Now, directly after that we have the Our Father. What would Dr. Guest like to do next? Would you like to do...
I don't know, let's be straight about this. After that's coming the Our Father.
That's right.
Yes, the Our Father.
And then straight on with the responses in A today.
A.
Please. You don't want to try that, do you?
Not for my sake, no.
No, but I don't think we do. Just we do the very first one. Could I have an A, please?
O Lord, open thou our lips.
Our mouth shall show forth thy praise.
O God, make save us.
How is that, Barry?
That's fine. I think you're put a tiny bit on the bright side.
Yes, I thought that. Yes, it could be that's a euphemism for can you please sing a bit quieter? Can we just try it again? Just a little bit of that.
O Lord, open thou our lips.
And the mouth shall fall.
Is that better?
Yes, much.
That's the right level, Ted, for the volume. Because you're singing for drawing room, isn't it? Not for the
that goes on for about half an hour, the banter between the two of us. You don't need me to go on about Corian song. You can listen to it every Wednesday. The standards produced by our choirs around the country still make the United Kingdom the choral capital of the world. There's such a wide variety of venues and music, from the very traditional...
Thank you.
God afton och välkomna till Sverige på andra söndagen I advent. Good evening and welcome to Sweden on this second Sunday of Advent. As you join us here in Stockholm in this magnificent 300-year-old church for our meditation in words and music. Advent is a time of waiting, a time of watching, a time of hoping, a time of searching. We look for the coming of the light out of the darkness, the coming of the Saviour, the babe of Bethlehem. We watch, we wait.
I have one eye on my clock. This talk actually lasts for another 15 minutes or so. Do you want me to cut it?
No.
Sure? Right. I'd also like to say this. Live broadcasting brings its own challenges, especially in choral evensong. In any other broadcast, choral or orchestral, it's possible to find replacements for those who go sick on the day. But as far as cathedral treble lines are concerned, there are no deputies available just like that. And I and many of my colleagues have often had to broadcast without a complete set of boys. And I know the same has happened to those who've got girls' choirs as well. It's not all plain sailing at the BBC either. Things can go wrong, and have. For instance, what happens if the red light stops working inside the cathedral? That's the red light that comes on and tells you you are on the air. What happens if it doesn't come on and the organ just plays on and on and on?
Choral Evensong comes today from Norwich Cathedral and is sung by a choir of boys and young men drawn from churches, colleges and schools affiliated to the Royal School of Church Music. The canticles will be sung to Peter Aston in F, and the anthem is The Lord's My Shepherd by Stanford.
Lights which have been flashing at the announcement should come on steady. And the organ should come to a close or stop, and the choir should start the responses. I'm sitting in the van outside, saying to my colleagues, I don't think the red light is working inside. They're saying, of course it is. If it's on in here, it must be on in there. I'm saying, well, it's now 1 minute past four, and the organ is still playing. Why haven't they started? I'd better go round to the west end and go down the nave and see if I can get it started. I get to the west door, the bird says, what are you doing here? You can't come in. We've got a broadcast. The organ plays on, I take my shoes off. Going on. I run down the nave, I tap Martin Howe on the shoulder, as you'll hear in a minute. I can now retreat to the van. The organ may have actually stopped 3 minutes into the broadcast. Then there are those very isolated occasions. They are isolated when a deep pedal note on the organ can set up a sympathetic vibration inside the capsule of a microphone. Now, this is very rare, causing complete chaos at Guildford Cathedral. And just listen to this.
Thank you.
what about when the telephone line, as we used to use, to London goes suddenly dead in the middle of the transmission, and an important one at that? Just listen to this. Very embarrassing.
Unfortunately, we've had no luck yet. I hope we'll be able to return there as soon as we possibly can. In the meantime, though, I'm afraid it looks extremely unlikely that we're going to be able to go back to Oxford for the remainder of Choral Evensong today. So I'll tell you who, in fact, you heard. And the organist and informato choristorum was Dr. Bernard Rose. It's particularly unfortunate that our listening to Choral Evensong was interrupted today, for this was Dr. Rose's last broadcast of Choral Evensong before his retirement from the college.
And there were occasions in my time at the BBC when the quality, that's the technical quality of the line to London, simply was not good enough.
Rheinberger brings to a close today's choral evensong, which came on a very bad line, I'm afraid, direct from St. Patrick's Cathedral, Dublin. I'm sorry, too, that we had to fade the voluntary, but really there wasn't much point in listening to it under those conditions.
Not good enough by the BBC, I can hear you saying. But there have been occasions when the choir, or to be more accurate, I'm afraid, the clergy, get it wrong. And that doesn't make for the best start to any live broadcast.
Canticles come from Purcell's Evening Service in G minor, and the anthem is Ascribe Unto the Lord by S.S. Wesley.
The same thing happened with a lightning strike in Salisbury some years ago. And also Jesus College, Cambridge, the organ failed, and Stephen Shipley was then producing it, ran to the chapel, played the office hymn on the piano while the organist and the organ scholar struggled to get the organ going in time for the Magnificat, which they did, I think. But the most unusual, and this is my last illustration, the most unusual scenario of all occurred in July 1972 on the Isle of Jersey. Lovely psalm singing. Oh yes, there is something unusual. That is Guildford Cathedral Choir, and we were in residence there for a week on the Isle of Jersey, and we were scheduled to broadcast Evensong that Wednesday. The producer, the balance engineer, and the local priest who'd been away for a while were all due to fly from Bristol to Jersey that very morning. It was foggy, and all flights were cancelled. Radio 3 got through and said, let's cancel the broadcast. Not on your life, we said. We've already got the BBC van here. It's come by ferry, and the equipment's here, and we can get the microphones up because we have a helper. We persuaded them to let us go ahead. It still remains the most unusual transmission ever in the history of the programme. The lessons and the prayers were taken by the men of the choir. I retreated to the van to be the sound engineer, and the choir was conducted by another of the lay clerks. The complete broadcast is actually out there on YouTube if you'd like to hear it. Described in the publicity for this evening. I've unearthed some unique recordings for you, and I've talked about BBC choral evensong. Maybe there will be another occasion for the really juicy stories about what really goes on in some cathedrals. Deeds I have known and loved, right? So in line with current political goings on, it's time, as they say, to exit. And since my initials are very appropriate, this is time for the BR exit. The real Brexit. But before we finish, you've had to listen to nothing but musical snippets this evening. And I know just how frustrating that can be. Last night we had some complete performances from Roy. So, just for those who want to remain, a short but complete piece to finish the evening. And it's very unusual, this. I'm giving the last word to S and S. Simeon and Stanford. S and S. It's an unctimitis, yes. It's by Stanford and it's in the key of A. This really is a unique recording and only I have it. In May 1978, the Festival of Sons of Clergy celebrated 300 years with a huge service in St. Paul's Cathedral. They invited three trebles, one alto, one tenor, one bass from every cathedral choir in the land to come and sing. We had the orchestra from of students from the Royal College of Music. And we sang this huge service attended by the Queen and the Archbishop of Canterbury and everything. I was sitting in the Dean's Vestry waiting to start. The organ was playing. Knock on the door. Yes, John, is it time to start? No, sir. There's a problem. What's that? I said. They've run out of paper in the boys' loos. So I said, well, don't tell me. I said, go and tell the vergers. Can't do that, sir. They're already bringing the dignitaries in. The procession's already started. Oh, okay, go and tell the work staff then. They'll sort it out. Sorry, they're at the west doors, ready to open them when the Queen arrives. So I ran out of the vestry, my cassock, grabbed the first choir men I saw, ran up into Paternoster Square, into the supermarket, pushed everybody out of the way, bought toilet rolls, ran back, chucked them over the top, and we sang this service. This is the nut committees from that very service, and it's a lovely way to finish this evening.
one of your old St. Paul's choristers, Piers Baxham, yeah. who I'm told was an extremely mischievous chorister.
Absolutely right.
Yes. to come and give the most wonderful vote of thanks.
Oh, thank you,
Piers.
Thank you, Colin.
Well, what a joy, as always, Barry, to hear your tales, and of course a privilege as well, to hear such tales from a very long life in church music. Really lovely to hear that. And this evening to have had the illustrations of music from the archive. Thank you so much, Colin.
Well, no, that's all you.
We didn't use it in him. We've eavesdropped on George Guest in John's. We interrupted Donald Hunt.
Yes.
And we also heard Wilfred Davies singing, which is a first for me. Unique. Yeah. And you are unique, Barry.
Thank you.
And I know I was there. Yes, I think I was on that
project. You were. Yes, you were.
One tale you didn't tell them was about the chorister who made a mistake in song at St. Paul's. And in the vestry afterwards, Barry challenges this chorister and says, "Maxim, you made a mistake." To which I replied in my cheekiness, "I made two. I came here." Well, none of us have made a mistake tonight, I think. And we very much look forward to the next one, or indeed your book. Your next book, which will have the juicy details.
Yes.
If you join me in vote of thanks.